Muy buenas tardes a todos y bienvenidos a esta sesión de la Fundación Naturgy. Esta sesión se incluye y se enmarca perfectamente dentro de uno de nuestros objetivos fundamentales en la Fundación y es tratar de hacer llegar a todas las personas interesadas y con responsabilidades y que siguen con mucho interés este importante sector los temas de actualidad sobre la base de facilitar datos, información, opiniones, análisis que ayuden a formar, a su vez, pues, los planes, las ideas que han de contribuir a mejorar la presente situación, que sin duda alguna cabe calificar de muy compleja y en algunos puntos preocupante. Es, pues, este un objetivo fundamental de la Fundación, el ir contribuyendo. Y hoy lo hacemos con esta segunda sesión, entre comillas, sobre la marcha, a la vista de la enorme importancia que están teniendo recientes hechos respecto a los mercados energéticos europeos, en concreto los eléctricos y los relativos al gas natural. Son frecuentes diarias las noticias respecto a estos dos mercados, los cambios regulatorios, legales, las situaciones de los mercados y la terrible presión sobre precios que están padeciendo consumidores de todo tipo. El pasado día 4 tuvimos ocasión de poder conversar, analizar la situación en el mercado eléctrico con las reformas que se están planteando y con las diversas soluciones que se mueven y intentamos avanzar un poco en el conocimiento de hacia dónde podrían ir esos cambios, esas reformas que sin duda alguna forman parte de la ocupación de los más altos responsables económicos y políticos en estos momentos en el mundo y singularmente en la Unión Europea. Hoy lo vamos a hacer con respecto a los mercados mayoristas de gas natural. El tema es sin duda de una gran importancia porque ya es conocido de que la situación del mercado del gas natural condiciona un montón de cosas en estos momentos y está sin duda en el ojo del huracán. Y es que el gas natural no solo es importante, y lo vimos claramente, lo sabemos, para la formación del precio eléctrico, es decir, para el mercado de la electricidad, y sobre él se debaten importantísimas cosas en el seno de la Unión Europea y de España, sino que además y per se es una fuente energética fundamental para la industria europea y la industria española. Por lo tanto, lo que pase con el mercado del gas natural, con los precios, los volúmenes y la situación en la que se van a mover será motivo de gran interés, ocupación y preocupación para todo el mundo. Pero además se trata de un factor relevante para la transición energética que quizá en ocasiones no se ha tenido suficientemente en cuenta. Para poder hablar de estas cosas, contamos hoy con tres personalidades ampliamente conocidas a las cuales me voy a referir sin entrar en el detalle de sus respectivas trayectorias porque son sobradamente conocidas. Nos acompaña Christopher Jones, que a su dilatada experiencia en la Unión Europea además añade ahora sus conocimientos y su práctica docente en la Escuela de Regulación de Florencia. Y nos acompaña también Álvaro Nadal, quien además de su paso por el sector público con la más alta responsabilidad en España sobre el sector de la energía, es un conocedor y un seguidor, si se permite la palabra, permanente de lo que sucede en Europa y en concreto en España en el mundo de la energía. Y va a moderar esta sesión una vez más, y también quiero agradecérselo, Xavi Vives, profesor del IES y catedrático de Economía, quien nos va a moderar el desarrollo de esta sesión. Yo a los tres les quería agradecer muy singularmente su disponibilidad para estar hoy aquí con nosotros y el trabajo que han desarrollado para tratar de, en esta conversación breve, pero intentemos que profunda y esclarecedora, tratar de aportar luz al importante problema que domina hoy, sin duda alguna, el escenario europeo. Y es que sin ánimo de dar un guión de lo que hay que tratar, el problema del gas natural parece ser que hoy está centrado en que, claro, es que es muy alto el precio del gas natural y eso condiciona un montón de cosas. Pero me atrevo a sugerir que, y sin duda alguna nuestros ponentes lo harán, que hay que abrir el debate inmediatamente. ¿De verdad estamos en un problema de precio o se trata de un problema de volumen? Es decir, ¿es un problema económico o es físico o son las dos cosas? ¿Se trata de un problema temporal, agudizado por la guerra de Ucrania, o realmente nos estamos enfrentando ya con el horizonte de la transición energética detrás o delante, como quieran ustedes verlo, a un problema más permanente? ¿Topar el precio va a significar que se pretende, por determinadas políticas a implementar a nivel comunitario y también español, no pagar tanto por la molécula, por la materia prima, o bien se tratará de una política de subsidios para paliar el gravísimo problema que los consumidores están padeciendo. Y si es así, ¿por cuánto tiempo y cuál es la cantidad a la que debemos pensar que va a ser necesario poner encima de la mesa? Cifras que se barajan ya en el horizonte de algunos países comunitarios son realmente extraordinariamente elevadas. Y si es así, ¿cómo se va a ajustar el mercado físicamente? ¿Va a haber una administración de la escasez y de qué medida si la variable precio desaparece? ¿Con qué criterio se va a aplicar y cómo se evitará la competencia entre las industrias del país, de Europa? Todo esto son, sin duda alguna, intervenciones en el mercado que la presente circunstancia probablemente más que justifican, pero que va a distorsionar gravemente los procedimientos por los que, de una manera habitual, nos movemos, actuamos, programamos y dirigimos las empresas y los consumidores, decidimos nuestro consumo y nuestros patrones de comportamiento. Todo esto es extraordinariamente relevante y será muy útil poder conocer la opinión de las personas que hoy nos acompañan. This is a great opportunity, Xavier. And hear their opinions on such a critical topic for the energy sector. I would like to give our thanks again to all speakers for their invaluable contribution and insights, and especially for the efforts in joining us for this important session today. Gentlemen, I will hand over to you. Xavier, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Rafael, and welcome to this session of the Naturgy Foundation on this very hot topic. I think we have a lot to learn. It's not an easy circumstance. There are no easy solutions. And so I think we have to be grateful to be able to debate today this issue with two of the best experts, I would say, today in the European Union. So we'll have Christopher Jones, who is professor now at the Florence School of Regulation. He joined, I think, Baker McKenzie, a consultancy. He's former EU energy director. And I think, Christopher, that you've had all the positions possible in the European Commission on energy. You can correct me, but I'm not going to name them because I think you have had them all, okay? Also, you are an expert in competition policy. You have thought about how to introduce competition in the energy sector. And also, you have thought quite a bit and you've been involved in the energy transition. Then we have Álvaro Nadal, who is now chief advisor at the Economic and Commercial Office of Spain in the United Kingdom in London. Has been Minister of Energy in Spain. He has been held many positions in the Spanish government, junior minister, director of the economic cabinet of the president. He has also been a member of Congress, responsible for defining economic policy of the Popular Party in Spain, and he's a well-trained economist. So thank you very much for being here. I'm looking forward to this debate. As you know, the European Union is thinking and has proposed several measures to confront the current crisis. Possibly it would be good to start thinking, where are we and what are the key issues to consider? No? At the end of September, the European Union agreed to a regulation on an emergency intervention to address high electricity prices and indicated that electricity demand should be reduced. It indicated also that it would be good to have a cap on market revenues on inframarginal generators in electricity, so those that do not pay the marginal price, which typically is the gas one, but still benefit from high electricity prices. These are such as renewables or nuclear. Plus, profit clawback on oil and gas companies, although I think then in the conclusion of this, maybe did not specify very well the gas thing, but still is there. And now, the big debate is about whether we have to put a cap on the price for the purchases of gas. Also oil, but today we'll deal, I will talk about cash. So the first general question I would like to pose to Christopher and Alvaro is whether do you think we are doing enough and if we are doing it in the right direction? As you know, we have accumulated gas reserves for the winter, and they are up to even to 90%, I think. And the price for delivery of gas in December is down. So all this, in principle, they are good news. But what if the winter is very cold? Would we be in trouble by March? What about if we exhaust all these reserves? How will we replenish them for the next winter, for the winter 2023 and 24? So let me start with Christopher. So first in your vision. And so I would appreciate so responses not extremely long so that we can have a more vivid debate.
Okay. Christopher. So are we going in the right direction? In the 30-odd years that I've been dealing with energy policy at the Commission and then outside, it's never kept me awake at night in terms of what it may do for my children, my grandchildren, society. And now it keeps me awake at night, it really does. So we have energy prices anywhere up to 10 times that we had a year ago, a year and a half ago, which are not really shared by our major competitors. It's not the same in the US, for example. And the problem is that this is potentially likely to be a three-year problem, not a one-year problem. Because basically what's happened, we've taken 100 billion cubic meters out of the market, out of the global gas market. Russia simply can't evacuate them, certainly for the next 3 years. And so no matter what happens, gas is going to be very tight, and it could get much tighter. Because as you said, Xavier, okay, this winter our storages are basically full, okay? We should be okay this winter. But if Russia completely cuts off supplies, because a lot of the gas that's actually in those storage has come from Russia at the end of the day. So what keeps me awake is not what's going to happen this winter, but what's going to happen in winter 2024. That's where it starts getting really scary. Okay, but even now, it's really worrying. I don't know if you know, but I saw a press release of Fertilizers Europe. 70% of all European fertilizer production is now shut, simply because of the cost. So it's a question of cost and availability, isn't it? Because they simply can't compete with imports. But the problem is we can't physically import enough fertilizer to make up for that fertilizer that's not being produced in Europe. And so expend that to methanol, all the other energy intensive products. And you can see a problem coming down the line as well in terms of inflation, availability of high quality food, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And so we really are in a bigger problem than most people think, actually, and it is really worrying. It can go well, the world can become a better place, it's impossible to predict the future, but if you see the worst case scenario, it really is difficult. And so are we heading in the right way? The typical thing you do when you have an insoluble problem, this is an insoluble problem, there is no right answer here, that's absolutely clear, okay? There are a series of bad options, that's all we have in front of us, a series of bad options. And what we've done at the European level and member states level is we've started with the easy bad options. And now we're getting towards the difficult bad option, which is wholesale price caps. So we've gone through the caps, price caps, national subsidies. We realize, okay, it's going to cost us too much. We've been through the Iberian model, which has a lot of problems with it. And certainly you can't use it in the European level overall. It's absolutely impossible. Happy to explain why, but try and use the Iberian model as Europe as a whole, it'd be crazy. The inframarginal revenues model that's been implemented by the regulation will not raise anywhere close to the amount of money the member states are going to need to subsidize both citizens and industry. So we're kind of putting sticking plasters over a big wound at the moment. And the question is, do you actually want to do serious surgery, which is the wholesale price cap? But hey ho, it's really difficult to do.
Thank you. Alvaro, what's your take?
My point is that we need to deal with a problem of scarcity. Prices are high because of scarcity. There is a lack of resource in the world. Although gas is not a commodity, for example, prices in the US are 6 times or 7 times lower than in Europe, it is very true as well that the reason for which prices are that high is because there is a lack of gas in the world. So it's impossible to solve the problem if we don't increase the amount of gas or we reduce substantially the amount of gas we are using, which are not easy to do in any case, because it's not easy to substitute, for example, our heating in our homes or how industries produce from the side of demand. And so from the side of supply, it is very true that we have very high prices that should create an incentive to invest more in extraction, liquefaction, make it liquid, and transport of gas, and then regasification to our shores. But in fact, they are not investing that much. Our suppliers are not really, don't feel the incentive to do that. And it's very interesting, for example, to read the last report from the International Energy Agency, in which they state two things. First, that although there are many plans of investing for more extraction of gas and more transport of gas, not so many of those plans are being implemented. And the second point is that in case they want to be implemented, they have huge difficulties in being funded, in being financed, because financial markets don't want anything that doesn't look like green financing. For example, BBVA, the second largest Spanish bank, has announced that last week that they are going to reduce their portfolio in gas and oil investment or credits, but about 30% in the following years, in the next years. So we've got a problem first that we don't have the resource. Secondly, those who could invest in increasing those resources and selling them to us and to the rest of the world are not really willing to do that because they feel that they have regulatory issues. For example, we have passed many regulations in the European Union stating that after 2035, we are not going to buy a single molecule of gas or a single liter of gasoline. So, for example, in the case of oil, refining capacity is 7% less now than it was before the pandemic, and almost no new refineries are being built and invested in. So that means that in the case of oil, the refining margin has tripled in the last years. That's why even with the same prices we had in 2012, at that time with about $100 per barrel of oil, prices of gas were about 1.5, 1.6. Now with more or less the same prices or even less, prices of gas, gasoline, I mean, are about 2. So there is a lack of investment, there is a lack of supply, and we are not doing much to assure our providers, our suppliers, that their investment is worthwhile. So the ideal would be to be able technologically to substitute gas and oil by other means. But in fact, we cannot. That's what we are suffering in this crisis. We cannot do it so easily and so rapidly as the circumstances would have demanded. So when we have a scarcity and prices go up, we can blame the prices. That's what in the current European politics we are doing. We are blaming the prices, but the prices are only the messengers. So that's what I feel. So we can do whatever we want to do with prices. All economists know that in a competitive market, if you do things, strange things with markets, with prices, you will have strange outcomes in one way or the other. So that's why Christopher said that we are going through the bad solutions, but in fact, they are not bad solutions. For example, the example of subsidizing the gas and electricity bill of a household. Okay, you subsidize it with what? With taxes? Then you are paying more or less the same because you are paying one part through your price and then another part through your taxes. If you are doing it with debt, oh my God, then you've got quite a problem because you are increasing public debt and balancing your public finances in a way that markets didn't expect and probably think that your debt is not going to be sustainable. So at the end of the day, the problem is that in the case of gas and oil as well, Europe does not produce gas, does not produce oil. We have to import it and we have to pay the bill. So trying to avoid paying the bill through internal measures is impossible. You will have to pay one way or the other. The only thing we can do is to promote more investment in the producing countries to be sent that gas to us and to Asia. And I think we are not doing that very well. This is my point, least my point from what I'm seeing.
Can I just raise one more thing?
Sure.
That I didn't mention. There's one thing that we're not doing well at the end of the day. If you look at when this crisis happened, the Commission did its repower EU communication, said we have to do exactly what you're talking about. We have to change the way we get gas, we have to reduce the amount of gas we use, but above all, we have to increase the amount of renewables that we produce quickly. And what we're doing through all the different schemes is we're managing to create a system by which it's really tricky to invest in renewables. Because all the time, governments are changing the playing field for renewables producers with PPAs, with power purchase agreements. I mean, would you know today, if you were trying to sign a power purchase agreement, if you were an industrial company, would you be certain that the price that you are signing up for today will not be changed next week by the government? No. How would you set the price? And so at the same time, we're creating a huge obstacle to investment in renewables that risks killing the market for a couple of years or even longer. And that is a thing that I think we're losing sight of as well when we're doing this.
Absolutely. Just to continue a little bit with the general theme on whether we are doing enough and in the right direction, I would like you to try to be a little bit more precise on whether we're doing enough to reduce the demand and to increase the supply, because at the end is a problem of demand and supply. For example, on the increase the supply, what do you think should be the role of nuclear? Can it be part of the solution of energy, no, or not? What should we do? It's true that we do not produce gas, but there is the Groningen field in the Netherlands, which has a large capacity, but it has some problems with the neighbors, right? Should maybe the European Union somehow also subsidize the potential problems of these neighbors so that this field can be exploited? Because this, if I'm not mistaken, could be up to maybe quite a large percentage of what Russia was sending us in gas, no? This is on the supply side. On the demand side, are we on the path to reduce the demand for gas? Should we, for example, instead of subsidizing all consumers, try to subsidize only inframarginal consumption for those vulnerable consumers, but then let everyone, and in particular the ones that can pay on the margin, pay the actual price? Maybe I think Germany is trying to incentivize this saving on this account. So please, could you be a little bit more go a little bit more deeply onto the demand and supply aspects? So I don't know.
Demand, on supply, no form of energy is perfectly as economic and technological substitute of the other. As Christopher were talking about renewables are great, they don't emit, but they are not manageable. You don't have the resource when you want, only when there is. On the other side, gas and oil are storageable, but they produce CO2. Nuclear, they produce residuals, it is true, but it has a great advantage. They don't emit and it's affordable. The point is that you cannot turn on and off a nuclear plant so easily. So they need to work more than 8,000 hours per year. So they are only feasible for the base load of the system, only that, but we can reach up to there. The point is that I think it's very important to think that we are not allowing prices to do their job. Prices should be a signal for supply and demand in a static way. The higher the price, the more you produce, and the less you consume. And at the same time, they convey via profit the investing signal. This is very obvious, but I think it's important to remind this because it's not what we listen in energy policy in Europe almost ever, which is very important. So when we mess with prices, we are eliminating these signals for supply, for demand, and for investment. And it's not easy to do, and they're not going to be signals that are going to produce effects immediately, but at least they go in the right directions, and we are not doing this appropriately. It's not easy to reduce demand, but it's going to be even less if we're going to cross-subsidize all consumers. So we can think about that for vulnerable consumers, or perhaps it's better to give an income subsidy and not a price subsidy, would be the reasonable thing to do. By the way, because consumers should never lose the signal of what's going on and that energy is scarce, very, very scarce. So it's better to go through other kinds of consumption and substitute one consumption for the other. And the same case for supply. And the same case for industries as well. So if we are cross-subsidizing with huge amounts of money that at the end is going to come from the same place, what we only do is to lose the signal that we need to correct behavior in our society in order to make our crisis less bad, less evil. We are not going to make things better, but at least we can make things to avoid them to go worse. I know that that's not the typical political pressures. Governments would like to give good news, and it's happening. And even the European Commission and the president of the European Commission wants to give good news. But the news are that we have a scarce resource. And the only thing we can do is to adapt. And the better we adapt, and the sooner we adapt, the better. Is this going to last for long? I think that Christopher is right, because it's not only the war. The war aggravates the problem, but it comes from a lack of production and supply coming out from the pandemic. And of course, we have eliminated other alternatives that we had, and we don't want them for climate policy, like, for example, coal, which could be another way of increasing the possibilities of energy in our system. We don't want them. We have ruled them out because of our climate policy. Right, but it has a cost, of course. The important thing is to know the cost of all decisions we make.
Thank you. Christopher.
So, demand and supply. I fully agree that we're not doing enough in terms of demand reduction. So you have this piece of European legislation where there is a voluntary reduction target that can then be made mandatory when you declare an EU alert. I have not seen member states do really a great deal in order to try and achieve their voluntary target. For example, as you mentioned, the price subsidies tend to be for everybody, which in my personal view is absolutely ridiculous. Absolutely vulnerable customers should be protected, absolutely, no question. And the number of people who are defined as vulnerable are obviously much higher with these energy prices. But to give to us two, who are comfortable, price subsidies for energy is not, in my view, a good way of using government money. And it's also the way you structure them. There's a very good paper, German paper, which suggests that, okay, what you do is you restructure your energy bills, and 80% of what you consumed in 2021 is at a reduced tariff, and the last 20% is a much higher tariff. You do that, you create an incentive. Very simple, okay? You exclude the poorest members of society from that that calculation through a level of what is your consumption. So a great deal more can be done. And the problem is, by not attacking energy efficiency, we're ending up with demand destruction in industry rather than energy efficiency consumption reductions. Now, in terms of supply, First of all, in relation to the Netherlands, I fully agree with you. I'm a little perplexed why the EU has not sought to have a strategic partnership with the residents of Groningen. You could get 20 billion cubic meters tomorrow, like that, basically. And I understand the people who live in Groningen, okay? In the past, they were promised from the Dutch government action to deal with earthquakes, damage to houses, and I understand that the money was not forthcoming quickly enough. However, if you do the numbers of how much the Netherlands would be earning from this gas, you could give to every house in the Groningen €1 million, done, just like that, out of the profit they'd be making from the gas. So I don't understand it, but hey-ho, there you go. In terms of nuclear, I think we are seeing a bit of a nuclear renaissance, certainly in Central Eastern Europe, where there are many more plans popping up. And I think that will be inevitable as we move closer to full decarbonization. One thing I'm not entirely sure that I agree with you is that there is a fundamental problem of molecules. There's plenty of natural gas in the world. There's lots and lots of natural gas. There's plenty. We could toast the planet five times with the amount of natural gas in terms of reserves. The problem is it's all in the wrong place, from our perspective.
And you need to take that gas and transport it.
You need to take that gas, and so there isn't enough LNG capacity. But markets will rebalance. That's the nature of markets. Because we have high prices, people will invest. But of course, the other thing is we're managing to shoot ourselves in the foot by the European Parliament at the same time introducing proposals to phase out gas completely by 2035. So I'm going to invest in LNG in order to supply the EU for 8 years, 7 years. Okay, that's fine because China will then step up. It's probably not the right word in terms of climate change, but hey-ho. But for example, the EU has no policy on carbon capture and storage. It's the illegitimate child of energy policy, whereas all the studies say without carbon capture and storage at huge quantities, we will not be able to meet our climate change goals in 2050. But we don't have a policy. So there's an awful lot that can be done, which is not being done, in order to send the right messages to people, because it's only going to be LNG. We're not going to get more gas from Algeria. We're not going to get more gas from Norway. They've negotiated another 10 BCM from Azerbaijan, but that's it. Then you're done, if we ever get that. So it's the whole story is LNG at the end of the day. And we need to incentivize the production and import of that. It will come, but before 3 years, good luck.
And they have to finance it. And now it's green financing.
Yes,
everywhere.
Absolutely. Let's move on to a related topic on the same theme, which is on the market integration and to what degree the gas market in particular, because we are concentrating on this, is being integrated in Europe, and how also different versions, for example, of what the European Union wants to do, different versions of the European Union mechanisms to deal with a crisis, which may be specific to different national governments and national intervention, may help or interfere with this market integration, taking into account, for example, that the distributional consequences are very important. No? For example, there have been arguments that 200 billion euros help to firms and other consumers in Germany. It somehow may distort competition in the market in the EU. We see the national interest, like for example France, seeming to oppose more interconnection for gas with the Midcat in Spain. So how do you perceive the problems of the market integration in gas in Europe, and in also at the same time the scope for national intervention?
Please.
I think there is a constant in Europe's history that when we've got a very big crisis, then our single market fades, has its problem. There is a big temptation from governments to start changing the rules at national level. That happened in the 70s with the energy crisis, and that led later on to the Single Act. It was true, but in that time, the 70s, many governments tried to do what they wanted, not only in energy but also in any kind of cross-border trade. And probably we are seeing more or less something a similar trend right now. It's always very natural and we should have learned from history, in fact, but we don't. That's at least my point. Talking about gas market integration, I think the most important thing, of course, is the physical interconnection, which does not exist, especially if we talk with the Iberian Peninsula. And this touches me very much indeed, I must say, because we tried to do our best when we were in government, and in fact, we were able to negotiate a package for the Commission to monitor the level of interconnections. But it is true that, at least is my impression, that at political level, in the highest levels of European institutions, they don't see at the same level the climate policy and the integration policy. They don't see it. They don't feel that they need to press governments and to press our politics, to do the same for market integration than for climate change policies. And I think it's quite unfair for those countries who are isolated, like the case of Spain and Portugal and some others as well. It is true that it's very costly. It is true that when you do cost and benefit analysis for the whole European Union is not such a great business, because of course it means investing a lot for not getting that much, but for isolated areas it is huge, the amount of benefit you can get from that. It's something I think hasn't even been very good understood at the core of the European policy and at the European institutions. I can give you a little anecdote about this. I remember the interconnector we are building right now, the electricity interconnector between the Basque Country and Bordeaux. Okay. It must be, of course, underwater, because the French didn't want to go through the Pyrenees, so the cost is enormous, more than 1.5 billion euros, which should be 10 times less if it had been done on ground. Well, as you know, the first thing, in order to do an interconnector like this, the first thing is both TSO agree on the technical project. So the Spanish TSO, Red Eléctrica, agreed with ERTE, the technical project. So they had just to send an email to their national regulators, in the case of Spain, the CNMC, and in the case of France, La Creux, just to start negotiating the economic conditions, plus the European money coming from the European Connecting Facility. Well, of course, our TSO sent the email in 24 hours. It took 4 months to the French TSO to send the email to the regulator, and only after I had a meeting with the French minister. And she behaved wonderfully, I must say. She did very well, but it took a meeting between two ministers just for an email to be sent. And this is not monitored, and it is not pressed and pushed by European institutions. So unless we have this, it's very awkward, and it's very complicated to understand from the Spanish point of view, at least when we were in government, why do we have to comply with all these kind of rules that come from the European directives and regulations while we are not part of the market? Because in many times they are extremely costly for us. For example, in electricity, ancillary costs in Spain are huge compared to any other country. Huge. But nobody compensates for us when we are applying the directives or when we are applying climate change requisites. So, and now what we are seeing is that we don't have only a fragmented physical energy market, but also it's leading to a fragmented internal market, like the case of the German aid, that, by the way, the Commission immediately said that they were going to change the rules of state aid rules, because that it would be easier to accommodate the German policy. Okay, that's nice, but we, all other European countries, have also our problems. What I'm saying is that at the end of the day, it's also a matter of how different pulses and different strengths are put on the table on European matters, and some matter more than others. At least this has been always our experience.
Okay. Christopher.
Very little to add.
The European version.
No, very little to add to that. I spent 10 years of my life trying to get mid-cap built, so very little to add to that. The benefits of the internal market are obvious. They're huge. We're two-thirds of the way there, probably, and the challenge is to make sure we don't throw out the baby now. Because now, once we get to start talking about wholesale price caps, we'll understand that the internal market also has costs, because it's meant to be sharing the pain and the burdens. And when there's a lot of pain, people don't want to share it. So I just hope, and I do believe, that we will retain the internal market measures. We will return to, we will maintain a marginless pricing system. But we're going to have a couple of really difficult years.
Very good. Okay, so since you mentioned the price cap on gas, I think it's time to address it. The price cap on gas is just to try to source gas more cheaply. The question is, obviously, can it be done given the present resource scarcity? And then obviously it will have implications for electricity pricing. That's what also we are all thinking. But how can it be done? So the question is, do you support this price cap on gas purchases? Do you think it's a good idea? That's number one. And then number two, if so, how to implement it? Because it's not easy. There is LNG, there is a pipeline. Apart from that, like the different system we have now with the Iberian exception, do you perceive this issue? Then if we buy jointly, how to allocate the gas bought? How do we solve this issue? So maybe, Christopher, you can start.
Okay.
I know that you have thought about that.
So let's try and unpick the problem and unpick the options, rather than saying, does one support it or does not one not support it? Okay. So first thing, okay, let's assume this problem is with us for 3 years. And next year, we can have an even bigger problem than we have now. Okay? Is what we have in place enough to meet our social industrial needs? And I would say probably not. Okay? So we started, we've already done this, but it's worth going through the list again. We started with price caps and we started with subsidies. Okay? And as you've said, the problem with subsidies is, well, we've got to pay them ourselves. Nobody's paying our subsidies for us. So Germany, because Germany's rich, says, okay, I'm going to put 200 billion down because I don't want my industry shutting down. And everybody else is saying, but hang on a minute, that's not fair because I can't pay 200 million, which is true. And it would benefit German fertilizer, steel, chemicals industry compared to Spanish. The Spanish would be closed, the German would be open. But do we really want to kill the German industry because the Spanish can't open? Do we want to kill the German industrial heartlands because we can't? That seems rather silly, but it's not fair. I agree. So this is a really tricky one, okay? So should we then have another European recovery fund for energy? So that we have collectively in Europe, we all collect the money together, like we collected 800 billion in debt, and we finance it with European money, which I think from a Spanish or Greek perspective would be a great idea, because it would mean that Germany would be financing your energy subsidies. And that's not going to happen. Germany did it once, they're not going to do it again. Okay, so that's off the table, right? Okay, so caps and subsidies aren't going to solve this problem. How about the Iberian model? That in a commission paper said perhaps we could do that for everybody. Simply won't work. won't solve the problem. Spanish prices are pretty much the same as European prices now anyway, electricity prices. And it doesn't solve the problem for gas at all anyway. It doesn't solve your gas problem. All it does is help a little bit to solve your electricity problem with lots of disadvantage and costs. And it cannot work for the EU as a whole. It would be a disaster. Then you have the proposal in the Commission's, the proposal, the accepted thing, in the Council decision, the inframarginal price capture, okay? Which everybody has to do, every member state will have to do. Commission, I think, says it will raise 17 billion in the EU. That will pay for the coffee of this problem, okay? So everything we've done today is a valid attempt to try and deal with this, but it doesn't solve the problem at all. Not in the slightest. It will help, perhaps, but it's not going to solve our problem. So what are we going to do then? What are we going to do? The only thing that you've got left in your armory then is a wholesale price cap, which is to say, basically, to Norway, Algeria, Azerbaijan, Russia, and our LNG price suppliers, sorry, we're not paying it. We're not going to pay 230 euros a megawatt hour. We will only pay a maximum of 100. Okay? That's the way it works, okay? So let's assume we do that. And we'll talk in a minute about how you would do it and what are the problems. Because it sounds a lot easier than it is. Okay? So the first is, what would Norway do if we said, sorry, we're not paying you 230 euros, we'll only pay you a maximum of 100? Norway would probably say, okay, fair. It's still five times what I was paid for 2 years ago, and I'm still making an embarrassing amount of money. They'd probably accept it. Algeria, probably the same. I'm not taking bets on that. Azerbaijan, I don't know. How would Russia react? Because Russia's still supplying quite a bit of gas to the EU through Turk Stream and through the Ukraine route. If Russia would act rationally to that, they would cut supplies completely in order to test our resolve. And if the EU had said, well, we're going to keep our price caps without your gas, then they would actually increase volumes in order to make as much money as they are now to finance their war. But you'll recall that I said that was a rational response. Anybody who wants to bet on a rational response at the moment, well, we'll get to LNG at the moment, okay? Because another thing is, how do you have a price cap and continue to attract all the non-contracted global LNG you can, right? So what are the models? How could we do it? Okay, so obviously, first of all, we would make energy efficiency in the direct in the regulation obligatory. We'd go from the voluntary to the obligatory energy efficiency savings, but that still wouldn't be enough. Okay, so what could you do? Now, here's the problem with a price cap. The problem, as you mentioned, in Europe is it's not. We don't have high prices because Russia's saying, I'm only going to sell you at 200 euros a megawatt hour. It's because we don't have enough molecules. So people are competing against each other for molecules. And like in any market, when supplies are short, prices go up. Prices are set by the marginal unit, right? So the problem that we have is not that the price is too high. The problem we have is because the price is too high because we don't have enough molecules. Now, how do you allocate supplies when you have scarcity? Through prices. The people who need the stuff the most pay the most. And at the moment, Germany, German industry, German consumers are willing to pay more than anybody else, which is pushing the price up. Price competition. So if you have a wholesale price cap and you say Europe as a whole is only going to pay 100 euros, you don't have that price mechanism anymore. You don't have a price mechanism to allocate scarce capacity, okay? So that is why you have two camps in Europe. You have the molecule-rich countries, like Spain, like Italy, like Belgium, who are supplied by pipeline gas, that if you had a price cap, they'd still have enough gas. And then there were ones that used to be supplied by Russia, who, if you have a price cap, would have even less gas than they have now because they couldn't compete for the gas, okay? So if you have a price cap, how do you allocate your scarce capacity? And that's the problem with a European wholesale price cap. And that is why Germany, for example, and other countries are saying, no, 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 no. And why the countries that are molecule rich are saying, yes, please, let's do that. Because the downside is not so much. So how could you do it? Okay, so you could simply say in European legislation, we will have a mechanism to cap TTF, the Dutch wholesale market, and require other wholesale markets to follow. We just say by law, 100 euros a megawatt hour. You oblige TSOs to give unlimited balancing power. So you could always buy at 100 euros, so nobody has an interest in paying more, okay? And for example, you could leave competition open for LNG so that governments could compete for LNG. Sounds good. However, there are many countries that can't actually use LNG. And so as many Central Eastern European countries, how on earth would they get enough gas? They can't pay enough for it. So all the gas would be stuck in Spain, the Netherlands, Belgium, Italy, the gas molecule rich countries, and these countries would suffer like hell because they'd have a lower price, but they'd have even less molecules than they have today. Okay, so whichever way you do it, and you can go through various iterations on the ideal system is you have a cap on TTF, you have a single buyer for LNG, that you collate all your volumes for LNG, and you have an EU single buyer, and then you divide it. Okay, but whichever way you do it, you come round and round to the question is, how are you going to allocate the scarce capacity then? How are you going to allocate it? Which means you need a solidarity mechanism between member states. Okay, so but what does a solidarity mechanism mean? It means that me as Germany or Romania or whatever, I don't have enough molecules. France, can you please give me some? Okay, that's what it means. Okay, which means that at the end of the day, when you don't have enough molecules, you always have a curtailment protocol. You say, I am going to curtail the ones who need it least first, and the ones who need it most last. So under curtailment, you would curtail your citizens last, and your industry you don't really need the most. So let's assume you have this curtailment list. And number one for industry is power in order to keep the lights on. And number 10 is bicycles, right? And it's the same in every country. So what a wholesale price cap means is that, put simply, France would have to agree to curtail gas to its bicycle industry and shut its bicycle industry so that it could give gas to Germany so it could keep its fertilizer industry open. That's the logical consequence of a wholesale price cap. So, would it be, then, so to answer your question, sorry for being such a long answer, okay? Because it's not a simple problem. Would it be a good idea? Let's think about that. Let's assume we do a wholesale price cap and we put it at a level that continues to attract all the LNG that we need, that we can get today, okay? Good, because it stops competition between member states pushing up the global LNG price, gets us cheaper LNG. Sounds good. Great. So if you would do that, there's lots of benefits. Yeah. Yeah. If Norway continues to supply, if Algeria continues to supply, if Azerbaijan continues to supply, and if Russia acts in a rational way, then we're in a pretty good place. We do that with LNG. However, you can only do that if you have a solidarity mechanism in place, which means that countries like Spain would have to accept that they would have shortages of gas for some people or industries in order to help out Germany in the case that there was real shortage in Germany because we don't have enough gas. And the question is, would you be willing to do that? That's the answer. That's the question. And so from somebody who's worked 33 years in the Commission, I believe that is not beyond the realms of Europe's ability. But people have to understand really what the problem is in order to be able to find the solution. And people haven't yet got to understand that a price cap means a solidarity mechanism.
Alvaro.
Okay, it's quite an issue, this one.
Yeah, that's quite an issue.
I think we can bring it down to two general categories. The first idea is if Europe is big enough and has enough monopsony power in the world, we can do something similar to an optimal tariff. For example, a tariff could more or less have the same result. You get those resources from the public sector, but international prices goes down as you are so strong buying this resource in the world that you force prices in the world to go down. You can do it through a price cap, you can do it through a quota, you can do it through a tariff, whatever system you want, to produce an artificial lower demand, at least in the markets, in the LNG, because it's the one in which you can more or less work this out. The problem is that I don't really know if Europe has this monopsony power, because we are more or less 1/6 of world's consumption in gas, which doesn't give us, it is true that it's not easy to substitute, but by ship it's much easier to substitute your clients. So if you don't have this monopsony power, then why are you trying to impose something similar to an optimal tariff? The first question I pose thinking about this. The second point is that imagine we have this monopsony power. Imagine the rigidities in the supply chains are so strong that at least for the time being, we are able to force our suppliers to reduce the amount of the prices they charge on us. Otherwise, we say we are not going to buy you. Then we wouldn't be a monopsony, but an oligopsony in the sense that a cartel, a demand cartel. And it's very, very, very easy to trick this cartel, because at the end of the day, the way to share the benefits of this cartel would be this scheme of curtailing or rationing that Christopher has set. But it's very easy to cheat it. It's very easy for someone to say, okay, there is a wholesale buyer for the whole Europe, but in the meantime, somebody is buying outside that single buyer, because there is a scope. There is a scope, the marginal cost and the prices that are being caused allow for somebody to get more supplies just cheating the cartel, like happens, for example, in the OPEP on the other side. So I don't find it is that easy, unless I'm wrong, to put this in place. I don't think that we've got this market power in the world to do it. And it's the same. It's another way of trying to get a solution from something, at the end of the day, more simple. There is a resource that is scarce, and we need to promote our suppliers to provide more to us. If not Russia, somebody else. But in the meantime, somebody has to invest in extraction and in transport of gas to Europe.
You know,
I
think you have to separate LNG and pipeline gas. Okay? So pipeline gas, we have monopsony power over the suppliers that we have. So that can be applied. Over LNG, obviously we don't. But it appears that one of the reasons why the LNG, global LNG price has been going up so much is that Germany is competing with France, which is competing with the Netherlands, which is et cetera. And the demand from Europe is the most, we're willing to pay the marginal
also
unit.
Also with Korea, also with Japan.
Absolutely, and but at the prices you have today are probably Europe to Europe, member state competition. And what you can do is to have two different approaches, which you have a price of 100 euros megawatt hour on the wholesale market, on TTF, and then you have contracts for difference between the TTF price and the global LNG price. So the global LNG price floats where it is, okay? But if you have a single buyer, you get rid of the member state to member state competition.
What prevents Algeria to send their gas instead through the pipeline, they send it by ship?
They don't have enough LNG capacity.
Unless there is this rigidity, but sooner or later, and somebody will have a little bit of flexibility. You are going to reduce world supply on this.
No, absolutely. This has to be a 2-3 year mechanism. And in 3 years, Algeria will not have more LNG capacity. There's not enough boats, there's not enough regas terminals. Also gasification terminals. So we have monopsony power with Norway, Algeria, and to a certain extent, Azerbaijan, certain extent. So you can have a divergent approach, and so you can have contracts for difference for LNG, let the global LNG market float, and then see where that lands. But because LNG is only 25% of actual our gas consumption, even if you had €100 a megawatt hour on the wholesale price and you let the LNG float, you'd still have a much lower European price. However, as you say, once you start unpicking the details, it gets incredibly complicated.
That's it, because we are not a single buyer.
When you mess with the market, it gets complicated. But you can construct ways to do it. And I mean, what you said, Xavier, is do you think they're a good idea? Wow.
Yes. At the end of the day, we have to decide something.
It might be the least worst idea we have.
Okay. So, and if we were to go towards trying to exploit, you know, the potential monopsony power we have, that I think we have some. The question is to what extent, as Alvaro was pointing out. Would it make sense to try to put this price cap only for Russia and the pipeline from Russia?
No.
Or not?
That would be a complete waste of time. Because firstly, all it would do is cause Russia to cut full supplies. And secondly, even if they didn't, it wouldn't change anything because the problem is lack of molecules. They're not going to start suddenly increasing the amount of molecules they supply us if we have a price cap only on Russian supplies. They'll reduce it. Putin's already said he'll cut. So that would only make the situation worse, not better.
Yeah.
But Russia can sell its gas elsewhere quickly or not? Because this is important.
No,
right?
It can't. I mean, they supplied 150 BCM to us a year ago. Now it's, I don't know recently, but you're down to 30, 40, 20, something like that. So there's 100 BCM a year, which is captive. That's the problem.
Yeah.
Because that's in the western part of Russia. So it can't be supplied by pipeline to China. They don't have LNG capacity. They can't build LNG terminals because of technological sanctions. So that is captive. And that's one of the reasons you say the market's going to be tight over the next 3 years anyway, until more gasification capacity can be developed in the US in particular.
But perhaps we are not thinking in Russian terms, in the sense that they are increasing their pipes to China very rapidly. They have doubled the amount of interconnection in the last 5 years. In fact, China is reducing LNG demand because more and more gas is coming from Russia. So it's not a matter that they cannot sell their 100 BCMs, as they are selling more on the other side of the world. So for them, it's just how the amount of money they're making. So I don't make money in Europe, but I'm making the money in Asia. There is a good tale. It's set in London about the Russian mentality. Perhaps it's right and perhaps it's wrong. This tale of a Russian farmer that is in his land, and he sees a bottle, opens the bottle, and the genie comes out. And the genie says to him, okay, I can give you whatever you want, but under the condition that your neighbor is going to get double. And he says, okay, take one of my eyes out, please. So perhaps is the kind of rationality we are dealing with.
Okay. Let's hope this is not the case. Since time is short, maybe we could move on towards to close the debate more on slightly long-term issues also related to the green transition. And one general question I think that we are worried about is whether, well, how to do this transition, to what extent to use the fossil fuels, in particular gas, how can we keep a kind of a long-term commitment from these gas suppliers if we need them for the energy transition, while at the same time, no, as we have mentioned before, we are saying that after a few years, we'll not buy more from them. So how do you see, or what should we do to smooth this transition? And in particular, with respect to the needs that still we'll have for a while, for sure, to use fossil fuels, in particular gas also. Who wants to take it?
Okay. I think we have to be very practical. We have two different targets to hit at the same time that are very difficult to combine with each other. Because at the end of the day, we want decarbonization, but at the same time, we need a smooth transition. The Americans are using a quite different strategy. Otherwise, their prices are totally different. They are investing a lot in R&D. Most of the technology we are using in Europe, as at least state-of-the-art technologies are now, come from the US. For example, in wind, or in solar. And what they are doing is they make the technology advance and they deregulate. We have done the opposite. We have regulated, expecting that somebody will be able to find out that the technological discovery that is going to help this regulation feasible, to make it feasible. Especially in storage. The key, at least from my point of view, is storage. We are very far from having a viable and economic, technical and economic viable storage system scalable to the whole energy system, especially in electricity. So we cannot, from my point of view, we cannot continue saying we will do this and that on that date. We can say we will this and that on that day, subject that we've got the technological and economic feasibility to do it. And I think there is some kind of change, a more practical change in the last time about this. For example, this debate about nuclear and gas, if they are clean or not clean in energy. In fact, they are not clean 100%, but they are needed. They are needed for the transition. I think that we are leaving behind that push, ideological push we have had in the past in energy policy in Europe. We are leaving it a little bit behind and being a little bit more practical. What's what we have to do? Never forget our final target. Our final target is to decarbonize our economy. It is true. But we have to do it in a way in which it's not only economically viable, but also politically viable. We cannot say, for example, when I remember some time ago when the last package was announced, that they were saying, this is going to create a lot of growth and employment. Come on, if you impose a constraint to a production system, an additional constraint, and all production systems are optimizing problems, you are going to get less production, less services, and less goods. But in exchange of that, you are going to help your climate. But if we are telling all the time that these kind of policies, instead of producing some kind of economic sacrifice to our populations in order to achieve better goals in other domains, it's all then impossible then to tell the people that what's happening, it's happening because of many other reasons. And by the way, now I say it's the war. No, it's not only the war. It's because our policies imposes constraints on our production systems. And we believe in these policies, but we need to know as population what are the costs for that. In exchange for that, we did this. We do this. And I think that is the political trap right now. We are in the middle of this political trap in the European Union. And I think we are starting to get out because of this crisis and because of the war as well. We are starting to get out from this trap in a moderate and sensible way, of course. Otherwise, you would have elections like in Italy.
Okay, Christopher.
With this crisis we have, it's interesting that the debate is no longer on decarbonization. It's only about energy security. And I think it's, and just being in the Brussels bubble, if you like, over the last 2 months, people don't talk about renewables anymore and what's needed to make them happen. And a lot of the measures that have been implemented are making it really, really tough to invest in renewables at the moment, which is as crazy as it can get. So the first point I would say, I think it's really important, is we should absolutely not lose track of our objective and of the fact that the best solution to this energy crisis over the medium term is renewables and energy efficiency, nuclear for those who choose it, etc. But what we do need is an evidence-based energy policy. And natural gas will continue to play a role. at least until 2050, and even possibly beyond in terms of blue hydrogen and carbon capture and storage with industries that may find it very difficult to use hydrogen in that stage. So what I would say is we need more of a return to a proper evidence-based policy from the Commission, because if you look at the Commission's modelling for 2050, it still sees the use of natural gas, but the rhetoric is very different. And so I think you need a clear leadership in terms of evidence-based policy, and that will give you the answer.
Right. You are asking a lot, I think, but advance towards the closure that we have to end at in a few minutes. Let me just ask, it's not an easy question, but at least if you could say the essence of what you think about this question, which is related to the gas market, but in fact is the wholesale electricity market. So should we keep the marginal system in the wholesale electricity market, yes or no, or how it should be reformed? And just in 1 minute, I know it's mission impossible, but at least please give your main insight on this thorny issue.
I think if we see the Spanish example, we didn't change the marginal market. Well, the only thing the government did was to subsidize the top marginal cost. So, okay, the effect was more or less similar to the price caps or revenue caps to inframarginal technologies. So more or less it's the same idea, no? To remove the producer surplus, thinking that as the marginal cost went up that much in the end, there is an excess of producer surplus. It's very difficult to think in a market in which, a kilowatt hour probably is the most homogeneous good in an economy. You don't distinguish one from the other. You can have different forces of generation, but at the end, the final product is very, very homogeneous. I think the key is firmity in the market. If you are going to be able to provide a firm supply or not. For example, an idea that was going around and I think is attractive, although as everything very complicated to do, is to say you can only provide to the market non-emission energy, that would be only nuclear and renewables and water, but they have to be firm. So you need backwards a backup market that would be gas. So in the end, the wholesale market is only with non-emission technologies, but as you are never sure if you're going to have the water, the wind, or the sun, and you have a backup market that is going to provide this service, but outside the wholesale market. This is one possibility. There are many others, but all of them have very, very big problems, because at the end of the day, we are messing with prices that are fixed marginally in a very, very or totally homogeneous product.
Christopher.
I fully share that view. ACER, the regulators agency, was asked that question, and they basically said, of course we should stick to the marginalist model. What a stupid question. Because it's very simply, once you start messing with markets, you get kicked in the teeth. Because traders will find a way to unpick whatever you've done. So the answer is, of course, you need to stay with the marginalist system. The question is, how do we keep the thing in place for the next 2 years, 3 years, until things go back to normal? Because they will go back to normal. The gas market, the fact that there's plenty of molecules around, they will find the place they need. The price will come down. The question is going to be 2 years, 3 years, or 4 years? But they will come down. And the marginalist electricity market, we need it for the next 100, 200, 300 years. So don't throw out the baby with the bathwater, as you say in English.
Okay.
We come from the gas plus market, in which each different plant had a standardized cost, and of that a margin, that each one was a regulated monopoly. And after the second and third package of energy under the proposal of the Commission in the 90s, prices went down dramatically because we made the different plants compete and incentives and the signals to investment were much better than the ones that were more or less regulated. So we can go back to the cost plus, but we know the result of those, and they were not the best.
Okay. I think with these thoughts, we have to close. Obviously, we could be talking about this for a few more hours, in particular on this last topic, because there is a huge challenge also not to integrate renewables with high fixed costs and low variable costs, etc. But we have no time to deal with that. So thank you. Thank you very much, Christopher and Alvaro. I think it has been an extremely interesting session. I have learned quite a few things. And also, I would like to thank the Naturgy Foundation for having us today and allowing us to give our views and opinions on this very important topic. So thank you very much, and I hope to see you in person on another occasion soon enough. So thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye now.